about the etiology of anxiety disorders from a cognitive behavioural perspective, the behavioural component is very much informed by Stanley Rackman's work, published in 1977. Rackman proposed three pathways through which people might develop fear. The first is through their own direct experience, which may become generalised through conditioning. So, for example, if you have experienced a dog biting you in the face, you might acquire a fear of dogs, which might then generalise to various other animals, or not. The second pathway is instructional learning, which involves the transmission of information relating to danger. For example, when a parent repeatedly warns a child to stay away from pools because people drown in pools all the time, the child might develop a fear of pools. The third pathway that Rackman proposed was vicarious learning. This is when you repeatedly see someone else, usually an important person in your life, such as a parent, behave fearfully when confronted by a particular stimulus, and then you develop that fear yourself. So that's a very behavioural perspective on the ways in which anxiety or fear may develop. Let's have a look at the kind of cognitive behavioural model that might be used to explain the way anxiety works to a client. I'll talk you through an example, just the way I would with a client, to explain how the elements of this model fit together. I'll give you a bit of background example about Sam, the subject of our example. Imagine that Sam is an only child, the son of quiet, introverted parents. Growing up in a small country town, he was quite shy and didn't have many friends. His parents tended to keep to themselves, and the family didn't socialise very much. Now, Sam is at university and living in college. One of the guys on his floor, Pete, asks him if he wants to go to a party. Sam says yes. He arrives at the party by himself. He gets as far as the open doorway to the house, where he can see people laughing, talking, and having a good time. But he can't see the mate who invited him, and no one comes to greet Sam. And now he's thinking to himself, this is going to be awful. I can't see Pete. Actually, I can't see anyone I know. No one is going to talk to me, and I'm going to look like a real loser. I wish I'd never come. This is an example of the cognitive system in action. As he is saying this to himself, Sam notices that his heart is beating really fast, that his hands have gone all sweaty, and that he's become flushed in the face, all manifestations of the physiological system of anxiety. And here we have a nasty little feedback loop between the physiological system and the cognitive system, because having noticed his physical symptoms of anxiety, Sam says to himself, great, now everyone is going to be able to see what a nervous wreck I am. His feelings of anxiety and uneasiness increase, and eventually he turns around and leaves the party. When he leaves, which is the behavioural system of anxiety in action, he is avoiding the stimulus, the party, and the thoughts that have made him anxious. The immediate consequence of his avoidance is that Sam's anxiety reduces. As he is walking away, however, Sam thinks to himself, well, I was right. I couldn't cope in that situation, and it was every bit as awful as I knew it was going to be. His avoidance has served to reinforce or strengthen his original negative thoughts, and next time he is invited to a party, Sam is much less likely to accept the invitation. Whether Sam is a 20-year-old university student, as in this example, a 65-year-old, a 13-year-old, or a 5-year-old is irrelevant. Anxiety works in the same way for adults, adolescents, and children.